As you are on your way tonight in the New Testament to the book of James, James chapter 3, we're going to look at six verses tonight out of this wonderful and marvelous portion of the Word of God. As we finish out James 3 this evening. For those of you that take notes or that like putting things down on paper concerning titles or outlines, tonight we're going to talk about wisdom. We're going to talk about finding it, losing it, and using it. James chapter 3, starting in verse number 13, the Word of God says, "Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace." An old woodman's proverb says, "A tree is best measured when it's down." The truth of this statement is found in that the size and quality of a tree's lumber can best be determined when the tree is on the ground. Now, I found this to be of great interest. Sunday night, I preached on Make Like a Tree, and this morning, as I walked up to the church office, the tree that did reside near the cemetery here across from the main building of the church was being cut down. Because as we get into the rebuilding of the block wall, the retaining wall that is there, it is extremely important to take care of the roots that have grown into that wall. So I again thought it kind of interesting that I preached on Make Like a Tree on Sunday night, and I walk up and the tree's gone. So it did leave us alone. So here tonight I'm talking about the fact that a tree is best measured when the tree is on the ground. What's your parallel, Pastor? Why are you mentioning this? This is also true in regards to the measure of a person's accomplishments that can only be seen many times at the end of his or her life. Often only then do we see the wisdom or folly in how a person lived. Did they live for only this world and the fleeting pleasures that it offers? Did they live only for themselves with little or no thought of others? Or did they live for Christ, for His kingdom, and for the desire to see others enter into an eternity of peace and rest because of salvation that is obtainable only through Jesus Christ? It is astounding to see that the words that James uses in James 3, verses 13 through 18, let me remind you of something tonight. These words are addressed to Christians, the ones that I just read to you. It's not to those who don't know Christ as Savior. It's to those who have trusted in Him as their only way to go to heaven. But it also serves as a powerful reminder that believers in the first century suffered from the same maladies and failures that plague us still today. Truthfully, it matters not when or where, people are the same the world over. And so James speaks to the issues surrounding wisdom and the lack of it. Wisdom was extremely important to Jewish people. They realized that it was not enough to simply possess knowledge. One had to be able to use the knowledge correctly. Many of us in this room may be acquainted with people that are brilliant. They may even border on genius. But those same individuals have a difficult time operating in everyday situations. You may have met some like this in your lifetime. They lack in social skills or interpersonal relationships. They may be highly skilled in math or music, but they miss it when it comes to the mundane actions of daily existence. They're brilliant, but they don't often possess what we call common sense. This is part of the issue with which James is wrestling in the closing six verses of chapter 3. He addresses it from the position of there being a vast difference between having knowledge and possessing real wisdom. And let me say to you tonight, and I'm going to stress this, there is a vast chasm between having knowledge and possessing real wisdom. A person knowledgeable in the truth of God may be able to take things apart spiritually, but only someone with true wisdom can put them back together and relate God's truth to the situation. It's kind of like this, and I say this very respectfully, that there's a gentleman seated in the back of the congregation tonight that is brilliant in regards to computers. Brother Jerry Leonard could take computers apart with his eyes closed, blindfolded. He could probably put things back together with all of those things being the case. I know enough about taking the shell off of a computer and maybe popping the RAM out of it. I know enough to where I could take the thing apart. I'm not sure that I could put it back together and make it function correctly. You see, there's a difference between knowledge and wisdom. In looking at these last few verses, James invites us to see the difference between finding wisdom, losing wisdom, and using wisdom. And so he begins with a question of wisdom. It's found in verse number 13. I want you to look at the words with me once again tonight. James says, "Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom." In all actuality, James is not looking for a show of hands when he asks this question. I'm sure that many of those reading these words wanted to think themselves as wise and knowledgeable, but it's like the question that I ask on occasions when I say to you, "How many of you want God to bless you?" Well, hey, if somebody asks me that question, both hands are going to be in the air. I want God to bless me and to bless my family. That sometimes seems as if it is a dumb question. Most people would raise their hands in the air when asked such a question, but then the page is turned and we hear the rest of the story for the follow-up question to what I've just asked. How many of you want God to bless you? The follow-up question is this: how many of us are willing to do what is required for God to bless us in the way that He wants to bless us? Now we're getting into different water. Such is the case here with James's question of wisdom. In effect, it is a rhetorical one. James is basically saying in verse number 13, those of you who think you are wise and possess understanding, oh, we'll just see about that. We must grasp the truth that there are many that are filled with knowledge, but are empty in regards to wisdom. They may even be those that have a little by way of knowledge. There may even be those that have a little by way of knowledge, and yet they express such wisdom. And I have seen this in my lifetime, and I'm confident that you folks have seen it as well. Someone who might not have even attended to the eighth grade of school, but can do math in their head and never have to use a calculator. But even beyond that, they have such words of wisdom that they would offer to us. So I'm going to mention some of this in just a moment. It's interesting how some people have more wisdom by accident than a lot of folks attempt to have on purpose. I heard someone put it this way one time, said, you know, if the mountain were smooth, you wouldn't be able to climb it. That one kind of takes a minute for it to sink in, but you know what? There's a reason why even the difficulties in our lives are the way that they are. Even the bumps and the humps that come along. James tells us that if a person is really wise, it will be shown in his or her life. Not by what they say, but by what they do. By what they are, James says. He uses the phrase in verse number 13. He talks about good conversation. You see that on the wall behind me tonight. When he uses the phrase good conversation, it is a phrase that has changed greatly in its meaning. Conversation now means talk. It used to mean walk. Therefore, it is better to walk than to just talk. You've heard me use this saying with you before, that your talk talks and your walk talks, but your walk talks louder than your talk talks. Again, that one takes a minute for it to sink in also, but there is still truth in that. Your talk talks and your walk talks, but your walk talks louder than your talk talks. The life of a wise person is seen in their obedience, get this tonight, to God's word. Intellect, skills, education, those things don't make a person wise. Obedience to the truth is what makes a person truly wise. But James takes his discussion a step further, even in verse number 13, as he continues to ask a question concerning wisdom. He takes his discussion a step further when he explains that true wisdom is also shown through meekness, through humility. Not much is said these days concerning these two character traits and the need for them. Even in evangelical circles, a person is viewed as weak if they attempt to be meek. But nothing could be further from the truth. Meekness, humility even, is simply strength under control. Humility is not thinking less of oneself. It is simply thinking of oneself less than you think of others, even. Let me take this opportunity to also explain that meekness, as James refers to it even here in verse number 13. Meekness, ladies and gentlemen, is a fruit of the Spirit. It is a God-given quality in the life of the believer that seeks to act and react and live in a way that pleases God. It's not just lip service. It's practical Christian living. That's what James deals with all throughout this book. We see a question of wisdom in verse number 13. But secondly, tonight, I want you to see a quantity of waywardness that is mentioned in verses 14 through 16. Not just a question of wisdom, but in these three verses that follow, we find a quantity of waywardness. Look at it again in verse number 14. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. So let's get down to where we live and breathe in these verses. And one of the best things that can ever happen at a time like this, on a Wednesday night, a Sunday morning, or a Sunday night, is to just let the text speak for itself. The ungodly wisdom, the unwise, the ungodly wisdom of the one that has lost all sense of true wisdom exhibits itself in a litany of wayward qualities. Envy, strife, boasting, deceit are all part of the lifestyle of one that has lost their way in the walkway of wisdom. From jealousy to selfish ambition, the unwise man or woman is filled with a profound sense of entitlement and even an insatiable hunger for possessions and positions. What they have is never enough. They're always judging their standing by what others own and what they don't own. Sadly, it doesn't stop with just the material. You heard the phrase years ago about people keeping up with the Joneses, or however the case may be, making sure that if your neighbor bought a new car, that, well, you had to go out and buy a new one yourself. Or if they got a new television set, well, then I guess I better not be the last one on my block that doesn't have one either. And so then we buy things we do not need with money we do not have to impress people we don't even like. James is talking to us about how that envying, strife, jealousy, ambition. But you know what? It doesn't just stop with material possessions. Sadly, it is even present in the ministry. And I want to address a couple of things right here very quickly. Spend enough time in certain Christian circles, and you will watch it raise its ugly head among preachers, singers, missionaries, and educators. It can even happen in the pew. A pride in what we have instead of a focus on what we should be. It takes root and causes the decay of many. Many go on constant ego trips under the guise of spiritual zeal or dedication. The wisdom of the world says this. It says, promote yourself. Tell others how good you are and how much you know. Always one up the other guy, even if he is a brother in Christ. That's what the wisdom of the world tells you to do. I'm going to be real careful, but I'm going to be real pointed on this tonight. When the wisdom of the world gets into the church, there is a great deal of fleshly promotion and human glorification. James has already ruled on this type of behavior. He says, "My brethren, these things ought not to be." If worldly wisdom is at work, humility and submission are the first qualities that are sacrificed on the altar of ambition. Those operating in such a manner want to get all the glory for themselves and not for the Lord. James concludes in verses 14 through 16 that an unwise person, take note of this, and this is where I need to interject again tonight, and I'll do it by way of a question. To whom is James writing? Christians. Believers. James concludes that an unwise person is arrogant, dishonest, worldly, self-promoting, and even demonic in their behavior. That's what he says. When these qualities are present, there is confusion, James says, and there is every evil work when these things are present. Christians that remain living at this low level impair the work of the church and they silence the voice of true Christian living when they do that. I told you when we started the book of James, it's not always fun, but it's real. We've seen a question of wisdom. We've seen a quantity spoken of concerning the waywardness. Finally tonight, I want you to take note of a quickening of our walk in verses 17 and 18. Having looked at the wrong type of wisdom, James ends with a stark contrast of the wisdom that is from above in verses 17 and 18. In doing such, he challenges us with a quickening of our walk. Look once more at verses 17 and 18 with me tonight. The Word of God says, "But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace." The truly wise person demonstrates his or her wisdom by their behavior and by deeds that are done in humility and in meekness. Over and over again, we see godly character traits being mentioned by those who know what real wisdom is and how to use it. If our lives, ladies and gentlemen, have been quickened, have been made alive by Christ, then our walk will be quickened as well. If there's been a change, let me put it just in good old terms that make sense to me. If there's been a change that has occurred internally, there will be a change that will happen externally. Our words and our walk will begin to match in how we live and move and have our very being, Paul would say. We will desire to have these items present in our lives. And James starts listing them. He talks about purity and peacefulness, patience, pleasantness, productivity even, in all of these phrases that he uses in verses 17 and 18. All of these items will flow from the heart and lips and life of a person endued with godly wisdom, James says. All throughout verses 13 through 18, James has been showing us a contrast, a parallel between the wisdom of the world and the wisdom from above. He's been showing us back and forth. But the contrast can't be more clearly seen than in the lives of two Old Testament men. Their names are Abraham and Lot. Lot followed the wisdom of the world. He chose to pitch his tents toward the well-watered plains of Jordan. In fact, after the disagreement between he and Uncle Abraham, and Abraham gives him the choice. Which way do you want to go, Lot? You choose first, I'll go the other direction. And Lot decides to go towards the well-watered plains of Jordan. Hey, that looks a whole lot better than this desert area over here that I'll leave you with. Lot goes in that direction. Before long, Brother Jerry, he is found in a city by the name of Sodom. Not only has he become a resident of that city, Scripture tells us that with him sitting in the gate of Sodom, Brother Terry, that indicates that he even has some sort of position of authority, ruling position, judge, or something of that nature. He held a position within that place of intense wickedness. I want to be careful when I say this tonight. When the angels came to rescue Lot and his family from Sodom before God's judgment fell, Lot was so far gone into the world's type of wisdom that he offers his two daughters to the men of the city as they were wanting to have a relationship with the angels. I got to tell you, there's going to be something wrong with a guy to offer his two daughters to the riotous crowd. Every decision that Lot made produced works that were worthless. And everything he lived for went up in smoke. Bad play on words, but Lot lost a lot in Sodom. By contrast, Uncle Abraham made decisions that on the surface might have initially looked foolish. He went out looking for a city that had foundations made by God. While far from perfect, Abraham desired to serve God with his actions and his reactions, and there's no higher place of that being shown than in Genesis 22 on top of Mount Moriah. Let me quickly remind you, Abraham has been told by God, take thy son, thine only son, Isaac, and sacrifice him unto me. Brother Terry, Abraham and Isaac leave the servants at the base of the mountain and are going forward to worship, he tells the servants. But there's something really unique about all of that. Abraham says, I and the lad will go yonder and worship and will return unto thee. You know, Abraham was far from perfect, but he trusted God. He made choices based on wisdom from above, not the world's type of wisdom. His choices led, get this tonight, church, to blessings for his own household and ultimately for the whole world because of the choices. Please do not tell me tonight that one man doesn't make a difference. That one man's choices do not make a difference. They do make a difference. And Abraham trusting in the Lord, his choices led to blessings for the whole world. The Christian life, according to James and according to Paul, is a life of sowing and reaping. Even the life we live will enable the Lord to give the fruits of righteousness and peace into others' lives. Simply put, we are what we live, and we live what we sow. What we live, we sow as well. If we live in God's wisdom, we sow righteousness and peace, and we reap God's blessings, James tells us. But if we live in man's so-called wisdom, we sow sin and discord, and we reap confusion and every evil work. Here's how Paul put it in Galatians chapter 6. As he would talk about the law of sowing and reaping, be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth unto the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth unto the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. James is just agreeing with Paul in this law of sowing and reaping. Whose wisdom are you using in what you are planting right now? And what, pray tell, are we planting in our garden this year? May the Lord add his blessings to his word.